why do synchronized oscillations give rise to how something seems, to the blueness of a blue experience? Why does consciousness happen at all? Why would synchronization do that? This research doesn't touch that question at all. Today we're talking about consciousness. And unlike every other reading in this course, where the readings were drawn from academic journals, the reading for today was an article published in Scientific American in 2002. It's written by David Chalmers, who is a very famous living philosopher of mind, and the name of the article is The Puzzle of Consciousness. To start off, Chalmers just tells us what he means by consciousness. And so we're going to read the passage that appears right in the on the very first page of the article where he explains what he's talking about. If you want a better sense of what consciousness even is, then you should go watch my video about Thomas Nagel's famous paper from the 70s, What Is It Like to Be a Bat? I will put a link to that video in the description if I remember how to do that. Okay, so that's the background material, but let's just start with what Chalmers says. This is on page 92. From an objective viewpoint, the brain is relatively comprehensible. When you look at this page, there is a whir of processing. Photons strike your retina. Electrical signals are passed up your optic nerve and between different areas of your brain. And eventually, you might respond with a smile, a perplexed frown, or a remark. Okay, let me pause there. So far, we're just talking about the brain. He hasn't gotten to consciousness yet. He's just talking about processes or events in the brain, neurons fire, whatever. What he goes on to explain next is this seemingly different thing, conscious experience. Here's what he says. But there is also a subjective aspect. When you look at the page, you are conscious of it, directly experiencing the images and words as part of your private mental life. You have vivid impressions of the colors and shapes of the images. At the same time, you may be feeling some emotions and forming some thoughts. Together, such experiences make up consciousness, the subjective inner life of the mind. Okay, so we get what's going on here. On the one hand, there are like neurological events in the brain, right? There's little electrical signals being sent or whatever, or chemicals flushing from one part of the brain to another, that sort of thing. There's that stuff happening in the brain, and then there's this other thing, consciousness. Consciousness is what it's like for you to see something that's red or purple or whatever, or what it's like for you to smell a flower. It smells that flowery way, whatever it is. That experience, that's called consciousness. And there's a problem with consciousness. Or really, Chalmers distinguishes two problems. There's what he calls the easy problem and the hard problem. The easy problem, or it's a group of problems, the easy problems of consciousness, I should write that down. The easy problems of consciousness are problems that can be solved by just doing more science in the style of science that we're currently doing. An example of an easy problem might be something like, how does the brain distinguish objects from just their background, stuff in the background, right? So if there's a marker here, right? Your brain figured out that this stuff is part of the marker and that this stuff over here, like the black over here, that's not part of the same object. That's something behind. That's in the background. Your brain is processing light data and doing something in order to distinguish this object from the stuff around it, the other light coming into your retina. Right? Okay, so that's a problem. We don't really know the answer to that problem completely, but we're getting there. We know a lot about it. That's an easy problem of consciousness. That problem is not easy in the sense that you could answer it, you know, from your living room or whatever. No, you need some expensive equipment, and scientists need to spend years following a rather rigorous method to do it. But these problems can be answered. Another easy problem might be something like, how does the brain produce grammatical speech? that comes out of the mouth? Like, which signals get sent where? And how does the brain, process the rules of grammar and stuff like that and to make the vocal cords move or whatever? All of those problems are hard in a sense, but they're easy by comparison to this other problem that Chalmers calls the hard problem of consciousness. The hard problem is basically this. In addition to all the neural processing that's going on, how and why are there conscious experiences that we have that are associated with whatever neurological things are going on in our brains? And what makes the hard problem hard is, A, none of the scientific theories of the brain or of psychology seem to be even trying to answer that problem, and also, it seems like more advances in those fields just couldn't answer this problem. That's what makes the problem hard. You know what? Let's just read what Chalmers says when he distinguishes the easy problems of consciousness from the hard problem. This starts on page 92 and goes over onto page 93 if you're following along in the reading. The easy problems of consciousness include the following. How can a human subject discriminate sensory stimuli and react to them appropriately? How does the brain integrate information from many different sources and use this information to control behavior? How is it that subjects can verbalize their internal states? Although all these questions are associated with consciousness, they all concern the objective mechanisms of the cognitive system. Consequently, we have every reason to expect that continued work in cognitive psychology and neuroscience will answer them. Okay, so those are the easy problems of consciousness. Now, the hard problem. The hard problem, in contrast, is the question of how physical processes in the brain give rise to subjective experience. This puzzle involves the inner aspect of thought and perception, the way things feel for the subject. When we see, for example, we experience visual sensations, such as that of vivid blue, or think of the ineffable sound of a distant oboe, the agony of an intense pain, the sparkle of happiness, or the meditative quality of a moment lost in thought. All are part of what I call consciousness. It is these phenomena that pose the real mystery of the mind. Okay, so now hopefully you believe that the explanation that I gave earlier of the distinction between the easy problems and the hard problem is really what was in the reading, right? That's really what he was talking about. He then goes on in the next page or two to talk about a famous article by Frank Jackson, or a famous example by the philosopher Frank Jackson, having to do with Mary's room. We talked about that earlier in the course, so I will put a link to the video on that somewhere. We're not going to dwell on it because we've already talked about that. Now it's time to try to figure out what the solution to the hard problem of consciousness is. And Chalmers discusses three potential solutions. The first potential solution to the hard problem is something that we could call optimistic reductionism. Optimistic reductionism is just the idea that we can reduce consciousness to physical processes going on in the body or the brain or something like that. And it's optimistic in the sense that we can't yet do this reductive explanation. We can't say that, well, look, consciousness is just that happening in the brain or that happening with the body and the brain. We can't do it yet, but we're optimistic that it will happen in the future. Another way to put this view is that all we have to do is keep doing more brain science of the kind that we're currently doing. And eventually, if we just keep doing more brain science, just like we're doing already, we will solve the hard problem of consciousness. We will explain how and why the physical human body gives rise to, you know, personal, subjective, phenomenal conscious experience. That's optimistic reductionism. All of the versions of physicalism that we've so far talked about in this course, behaviorism, the mind-brain, identity theory, functionalism, all of those are versions of optimistic reductionism as a response to the hard problem of consciousness. The second potential response or solution, if you can call it a solution, to the hard problem of consciousness is what Chalmers calls, kind of weirdly, but you can see why he calls it this, he calls it mysterianism. Mysterianism is also a form of physicalism. That is, it says that consciousness is just some physical stuff, some stuff happening in the natural world, made up out of molecules or whatever, like everything else, but it's something that we will never understand. It's, you know, inevitably a mystery. We are never going to explain how or why the physical events in the world give rise to and constitute consciousness. But they do. That's mysterianism. The third view is that conscious experience is just a separate thing from the physical world, anywhere resembling at all how we currently understand it. Consciousness is its own separate, totally fundamental part of reality. It is not something that can ever be reduced to molecules or anything like that, or neurons or whatever. We have a name for this view, and we've been talking about this view, you know, already throughout the semester, and this view is called dualism. Dualism, you remember, is the view that there's dual, that there's two kinds of stuff in the universe. There's the physical stuff and the mental stuff. Or maybe there's two kinds of properties. There are the physical properties and the mental properties. But the point is they're totally separate, and the mental stuff, or in this case, the specifically conscious stuff, it's just a fundamental part of reality. It can't be explained in terms of anything deeper, anything more fundamental. At this point, we're only two pages into the article. We've just talked basically about pages 92 and 93. Then, on pages 94 and 95, Chalmers makes the following point. All of the work that is currently being done in neuroscience only deals with the easy problems of consciousness. And he's not just saying that this work in neuroscience, you know, only ends up solving these problems and doesn't end up solving these problems. No. He's saying that all the work in neuroscience only even attempts to solve these problems. No one's even trying to solve this problem. We don't even have anything like an approach that would even get in the direction of solving this problem. We're not even trying at the moment. That's what Chalmers is saying. And to make this point, he goes through three examples of work that's currently being done in neuroscience, and then he just explains for each one how, look, they're only talking about this, they're not talking about this. I guess we'll just go through those three examples of research in neuroscience really quickly. The first one is from Crick and Koch. These are two neurobiologists who both live in Southern California and work at different institutes there, but whatever. Here's their view as Chalmers summarizes it. This is on page 94 in the reading. They suggest that consciousness may arise from certain oscillations in the cerebral cortex, which become synchronized as neurons fire 40 times per second. Crick and Koch believe the phenomenon might explain how different attributes of a single perceived object, its color and shape, for example, which are processed in different parts of the brain, are merged into a coherent whole. In this theory, two pieces of information become bound together precisely when they are represented by synchronized neural firings. Okay, so, like, that's some theory about synchronized oscillations or neural firings going on in the brain, right? So you've got certain, like, wigglings or zappings or whatever in the brain, and they're synchronized. They happen at the same time. Okay. You'll notice that this research, no matter how much of this research we do about how much synchronization there is between some oscillations in the front part of the brain and the back part or over here and over there, right? As much research as we could possibly do into that, that will only ever get at some easy problems of consciousness, right? Like, maybe they're right. I mean, it's very, you know, cutting-edge research and it could turn out to be totally wrong, but maybe they're right that the way that the brain takes some information and combines it with some other information is by, you know, having the two parts of the brain that represent that information oscillate at the same frequency or synchronize their oscillations or whatever. So what? That's only ever going to answer problems like, how does the brain combine two pieces of disparate information? That's an easy problem. the hard problem of why do synchronized oscillations give rise to how something seems, to the blueness of a blue experience? Why does consciousness happen at all? Why would synchronization do that? This research doesn't touch that question at all. Okay, and then the second bit of research in the area that Chalmers talks about is work that was done in the 80s, late 80s and early 90s by the philosopher Daniel Dennett. We get a very vague and very brief characterization of what Dennett says. Here's what Chalmers says about what Dennett says. Dennett laid out a sophisticated theory of how numerous independent processes in the brain combine to produce a coherent response to a perceived event. Okay, whatever. So say that Dennett is right. Say that, you know, the brain combines disparate sorts of things and it produces certain actions. And those actions, like moving your mouth and making sounds or your arms and legs, all that sort of stuff, those actions, you know, correspond in some rational, coherent seeming way to us. They correspond to whatever stimulus was coming in. Fine. That's just some easy problems of consciousness that are getting solved, if they're getting solved at all. Those are questions just about how the brain responds and produces certain reactions. We want to know how and why the brain gives us experiences at all. And nothing Dennett says, according to Chalmers, even touches on that problem. And then the last example of some cutting-edge research, this is sort of like the most cutting-edge and the most hand-wavy and theoretical, has to do with like quantum mechanics and all that sort of stuff. This is the research of Hameroff and Penrose. Chalmers summarizes it in like one sentence. He says the following. They hold that consciousness arises from quantum physical processes taking place in microtubules, which are protein structures inside neurons. And then I'm just going to read to you the very next sentence or two. This is where Chalmers says, look, that's only relevant to this. It's not relevant to the hard problem. It is possible, if not likely, that such a hypothesis will lead to an explanation of how the brain makes decisions, or even how it produces mathematical theorems, as Hameroff and Penrose suggest. But even if it does, the theory is silent about how these processes might give rise to conscious experience. So we've spent enough time talking about, you know, neurobiological research, neuropsychological research. Just to be clear that we're totally on the same page, which of these three responses to the hard problem are these research, if they're a response at all? I mean, Chalmers is saying, of course, that all this research only touches on these. But if we need this research to be done somehow, you know, in the service of solving this problem, which kind of potential solution or potential response would they be? The answer is optimistic reductionism, right? All of this stuff, if it's ever going to solve the hard problem, is going to solve it by just, you know, hoping that the kind of research we're currently doing is going to allow us to reduce consciousness to processes in the body or brain or whatever. Then, on the next page in the reading, page 96, Chalmers gives us his own response to the hard problem of consciousness. His response, as you'll see, I'm going to read it right now, is that consciousness is its own fundamental phenomenon, its own fundamental component of reality. Here's what he says. If the existence of consciousness cannot be derived from physical laws, a theory of physics is not a true theory of everything. So, a final theory must contain an additional fundamental component. Toward this end, I propose that conscious experience be considered a fundamental feature, irreducible to anything more basic. Okay, which of these is that? Right? If all of the neurobiological theories that Chalmers just talked about, if they fit into option number one, then Chalmers' own view that conscious experience is its own fundamental component of reality, well, which one of those is this? It's dualism. Chalmers is a dualist. He doesn't come out and say this with the same terminology in this article, but if he thinks that consciousness can't be reduced by our current science to physical things, and if he thinks that it's not part of the physical natural world, just part that we'll never understand. But if instead he thinks it's its own separate part of reality, then Chalmers is a dualist, even though in this reading he doesn't call himself a dualist. But then Chalmers points out a result that follows from dualism if you accept it. The result is this. Physics seems like its own closed system. By that I mean that all physical events can be completely and adequately and totally explained by just referring to other physical stuff. You never need, it seems so far, you never need to appeal to some non-physical, mental, spiritual stuff, some conscious stuff, in order to explain the motion of molecules. You can always explain the motion of molecules or various waves, electromagnetic waves or whatever. You can always explain all of that physical phenomena just in terms of other physical phenomena. So if that's right, then consciousness doesn't cause stuff to happen in the physical world. Here's what Chalmers says. Where there is a fundamental property, there are fundamental laws. In this case, the laws must relate experience to elements of physical theory. These laws will almost certainly not interfere with those of the physical world. It seems that the latter, that is, those events in the physical world, form a closed system in their own right. Okay, so we in this course already have a label or a name for someone who thinks that certain mental events, at least, conscious mental events, don't cause physical things to happen in the world. The physical world is its own closed system, and the mental stuff is just a byproduct that gets thrown off of the physical system. The name for that view in this course already is epiphenomenalism. I'm not going to explain what epiphenomenalism is in this video. You have to watch my video about Frank Jackson. Maybe that's already in the description to this, if I remembered to put it there. But anyway, turns out Chalmers, even though he doesn't say it in this article, has to be an epiphenomenalist. Okay, but Chalmers does think that there are law-like relations between the irreducible, fundamental, you know, conscious part of reality and the physical part of reality. And so these are going to be, you know, psychophysical laws. These are laws that connect the conscious to the physical, right? So psycho is going to be on one end, that's the psychological stuff, and the physical is going to be on the other end of each one of these laws. These laws are going to explain which physical stuff corresponds to which conscious stuff. Okay, so to conclude, I'll just mention some potential examples of psychophysical laws that Chalmers gives at the end of this article. These are just speculative. He's just guessing. He's not saying this is how it works. He's saying maybe these, there are laws sort of like these. One example, the first example that he gives is maybe it's awareness, like what neurobiologists and neuropsychologists call awareness. Maybe when that physical process happens, that's when consciousness also happens. So on this view, awareness perfectly correlates with consciousness. That would be one example of a psychophysical law. The other example of a potential psychophysical law is actually what we've been previously calling functionalism in this course, or, you know, you can take functionalism and take out certain parts of it and fit it in here. Chalmers doesn't call it functionalism in this article, but it's just the idea that certain ways of arranging physical reality, even regardless of what those physical components are made out of, maybe that's what correlates with consciousness. And then the third option for maybe a psychophysical law is something that has to do with information, like there's this technical definition of information that certain neuropsychologists and cognitive scientists use, and maybe it's information that correlates with consciousness. Maybe that's it. Who knows? Okay, but there are problems with all of these approaches. They're just guesses. The main point that I want you to take away is the difference between the easy problems of consciousness and the hard problem of consciousness, and how all of the research that's been previously done doesn't seem to be answering the hard problem.